Thank you all for being here. My name is Delma Delora. I am the president for this district, District 1199, New Mexico. We are a healthcare workers union. We have been around since 1974. We represent about 9,000 healthcare workers. And besides those 9,000 healthcare workers, I believe as a healthcare workers union and as a union that we represent and want to make sure that our whole state, not just the workers at our hospitals, but everyone is safe and that they're being provided the best care we can give them. So that's kind of my own personal feeling, and I know I went off, but I just have this thing that that we've got to take care of our community, and that's the only way we're going to be able to survive. So as things have been moving along, we have sent a letter to each of the hospitals saying we want to be able to sit down, we want to make a plan. This is like 5-6 weeks ago. We want to make a plan. I think we need a plan for how we're going to provide the care for the patients. How are the workers going to be garbed? Do they have the proper garb, the proper PPE? How are we going to do all of this? Because it's going to happen, right? And so we didn't get response. And so again, of course, calls and letters went in. Krista St. Vincent's was the first to right away call us and say, we're ready to sit down and talk. I mean, this is not right away, because it was like 2 weeks before everything happened, right? And they're like, okay, we need a plan, we have to get it together. So they called one morning and said, come on in, it's 9 o'clock, tell your boss, you've got to leave. And myself and the treasurer and some of the officers of the union went in, and they said, we want to make the plan. They already had a lot of things in line, but being that they have to negotiate and whatever, we were called in and the plan started at Krista's. Of course, we still didn't have all the equipment that was needed and whatever, so they said, this is what we're going to be doing. And they started theirs. Las Vegas, also, we have Yolanda, who is the rep over there, and the president, Marcos. They started working with the hospital management, trying to get things to happen. They've been a little slower. Los Alamos and Taos have been the worst. Taos said, I don't have to talk to you all. That's what the administrator said. I don't have to talk to you. You haven't, you know. And we're like, yes, you do. We're trying to make sure that there is, we're not like taking over, but we wanted to make sure that everybody was safe and that we had what we needed. And if we didn't, we could help deal with it. We could go out, we could mail things, whatever it took. Because when you're a healthcare worker, you don't mind going and taking care of, it doesn't matter what kind of patient it is. I know. I was around through all these flus. I was around when we had the AIDS epidemic. It had just started. And of course, nobody knew anything about it. And people were afraid. We weren't. We said, give us what we need to wear and protect ourselves, and we'll take care of any patients. All the TBs, everything that we have taken, that you have to take care of in a hospital. We just need the proper equipment, and we're in there. But if you don't give it to us, then we'll get sick. We'll contact whatever, and then you won't have any healthcare workers at all. So that was kind of how we were trying to deal with it. Los Alamos, a little bit of conversation. And it's kind of strange that a community like Los Alamos, that has the labs, that has all these scientists and all these people around who work there and are supposed to be, you know, that the hospital didn't even care to talk to us that much and to make sure that if they needed our help, that they let us know. Then as we talked and we found out that Taos, a community that's way out there didn't have our help because the hospital wouldn't talk to us. We talked about, let's call the mayor. Let's call the people who are the leadership. These are the people that are supposed to be taking care of us, the people. That's why we put them in office. You know, so we don't have people running around like me trying to help, but that it be organized and well done. And Taos didn't want nothing to do with us, I guess. They haven't really done much. We just heard today that maybe they're putting an area where they will be putting patients there. We have heard of a couple of people who have just quit because, you know, they didn't have the proper equipment. And you have families at home, or, you know, you don't want to go in there and bring everything home to your families. So after hearing all of that from Eleanor, who runs our union, I said, you know what? Let's talk to the governor. She stands there all the time and says she's there to help and whatever, and she's been great with us since she started running for office and whatever. We need to call her and say, help. We need help in these places. The healthcare workers have got to be safe. The patients, the families, the communities. And the only way that we're going to do this is making sure that the healthcare system is going in the right way and that it's safe. If you go in there, you want to make sure it's safe for you. You might be going in there for a broken hand, but you want to make sure that your surroundings are clean and all, you know? And so we did write the letter to the governor. And I'll let Eleanor talk a little bit about that because she's been in contact. And so I think I got carried away, I'm sorry. But I just wanted you all to know our feeling for this is just so great that we want to be able to help.
And just before we do that, Eleanor, you said 9,000 members. What jobs do those 9,000 members perform? Who are we talking about?
We're talking about all nurses that are not in supervisory positions. We're talking about housekeepers. We're talking about dietary. We're talking about x-ray techs. We're talking about respiratory techs. We're talking about maintenance people. We're talking, in some places, we have clerical people too. Pharmacies. The CNAs. In some hospitals, we legally represent all workers, as in Taos, in Las Vegas. At UNM, we don't represent every single person or, you know, occupation there, and at Christus either. But we are known to speak for everyone. You know, I know they're not members and they can't be because for whatever reason, the government has a list, you know, who can be and who cannot be in the union. But it doesn't matter to us because they're co-workers and they're working and we will help whomever. That's just the way it is. And especially at this time when things are so bad, we have got to stick together and help. But I'm telling you, I see the television news, I see New York, I see these healthcare workers there that they don't have enough gowns, enough masks, enough gloves. You wonder about the people who are cleaning. Are they using the same mop over and over because they don't have mops? I don't know. Because if you are a person mopping the floor, you have to make sure you have a brand new mop to bring in for the next room, right? Or the next time you come into that room. So do we have all that kind, you know, all that material that people need to work with? I don't know. And I don't want us, the state of New Mexico, to get there. We need to do something to help. We will do it. I mean, and it's not just our 9,000 workers in our hospitals that we represent, but this is all the people. I don't know how Roswell is doing. I don't know how Carlsbad is doing. How is Las Cruces doing? All those other hospitals. And what about the little clinics that are all over? Are they getting the proper equipment, garb that they need to be able to wear? Because a patient might come in there who's really sick, and you don't want to be exposed as a healthcare worker. So who's taking care of all of these people? I don't know. I just wanted the governor to see if what she could do. She has more power. She has more people who are out there in all areas, you know. That was our thing. And if we're out of line, I'm sorry. But it's all because we care for this state. We care for all the workers. And as a healthcare worker, I'm telling you, I didn't mind taking care of anything when I was an actual floor nurse, as long as you gave me the equipment and the education. Because I think if you can educate people on what can happen and how things are you know, carried from one person to the other, if you can do this, and it's not, that's why I think it's great that they're putting stuff out in the public. Because if you can do this to the workers, and give them the proper garb that they need and whatever, you know, we'll do so much better. So, okay, I will.
What has been the response of Albuquerque Hospital Las Cruces?
So in terms of Albuquerque, we only represent workers at UNMH. We have had two meetings with them so far to go over what we have as a proposal in terms of protecting workers. They have done some of the things that we've asked them to do. We on Friday had a session and asked that they relook at their visitor policy. One of the pieces that we think needs to be addressed is the number of visitors that are being allowed into the hospital. Our members have expressed the fear that not only will they bring in coronavirus or and impact the healthcare workers, but also some of these very sick patients that we have, especially in the ICUs. My understanding is that on Friday afternoon, they did exactly that. They restricted visitors throughout the hospital, because right now what they're doing is they're just letting people come in and they're being screened at the door, and we don't think that that's enough. So they have acted on that. The other piece that we have asked them to do that they have not done is reduce the number of workers in a room. We have received calls from our members indicating that we still have areas of the hospital where 80 or 100 plus workers are in one room all together. They're very concerned about community spread, right? And we need to stop that. We've asked the hospital to do that. They are looking into it. We are hoping that they act immediately. I think that we probably feel a deeper sense of urgency than maybe others do because of the fact that we are on the front line, that our workers are on the front line. And as Delma said, we need to make sure that that healthcare workers do not start falling ill because of lack of protected equipment, lack of training, any of those issues. We need to keep our healthcare workforce healthy so that they can prepare and be there when the real onslaught hits New Mexico.
Just what we're asking the governor today?
Sure. So basically the personal protective equipment. While some of the hospitals have assured us that they have enough for now. Do we have enough for the future and what that brings? We've seen what's happened in New York, Washington State, California. They're running out. How do we prevent that from happening here? We want the hospitals to meet with us because we have the members' interests at heart, the healthcare workers' interests at heart, and we don't want anybody to fall through the cracks. I'll give you an example. We had a phone call from one of our members in the housekeeping department at UNMH. They had not been adequately trained in terms of prevention and spread of this disease. We think that's very important. They also need to have the kind of protective equipment that everyone else has because they're going to be going into contaminated rooms. Mm-hmm. The other piece, again, I just talked about that, was the teleworking. We have many physicians that can telework from home, and we believe that all of the hospitals need to act expeditiously in that manner. We want the hospitals to make sure that if someone gets sick, one of the healthcare workers becomes sick, they need to be covered and their care and treatment needs to be provided for. We don't want any workers left out on a limb without any kind of treatment or healthcare coverage. We also want them to, we'll want the hospitals to provide administrative leave for those employees who may have to self-isolate and who actually have tested positive for COVID-19. And we are also asking, and we've asked this of all the hospitals in the conversations that we've had already with those who have chosen to sit down with us, we are asking hazard pay in addition to their normal wages, hazard pay of no less than 25% of their base salary. And that's just during this healthcare emergency. We need not only to protect them, but we also need to acknowledge that they are on the front lines, they are first responders, and they need to be treated as such.
Do you guys only have workers who tested
positive? I don't know that we have. That would be a hard question for me to answer. I do know that we do have a few who are in self-isolation because they have, the possibility exists that they have been exposed.
What has been the governor's response to the letter?
We have not received a response from the governor yet. We delivered the letter to her on Friday. We are hoping to hear something very, very soon. We had approached the governor actually several weeks ago and wanted to sit down with someone from the public health department. It didn't necessarily need to be her, but someone from the public health department that was actually involved in all of this, in the coronavirus planning, because we felt that we were being left out in terms of, you know, how we see things and some of the recommendations that we could offer. At that point in time, we were told that sometime after March 11th, then things got really crazy, so we needed to send her a reminder. So we're hoping that we will hear from her very soon.
What is the status now as far as garb and the equipment that you guys need? How are your hospitals and members being protected adequately?
So as far as of this moment today, all of the hospitals have told us, with the exception of Taos, I think that they needed to bring in some additional supplies. St. Vincent's had to get supplies from one of their sister hospitals in Texas. They have told us that they have enough. Again, the question is, that's enough for right now. If we get slammed, we don't know, you know, what's going to happen. They are asking the workers inside to conserve as much as possible, and they are, but again, they still need to be protected.
Mm-hmm. What should healthcare workers do if they don't feel like they're being protected right now? What are next steps? Who should they reach out to? Do they reach out to you?
They have been reaching out to us. And again, one of the reasons that we want to maintain close contact and have continued and often conversations with the hospital is to deal with these situations as they come up. So, you know, they are relying on their union to basically protect them at this moment in time. Mm-hmm. We have also asked the hospitals to also consider the fact that some of our members are, or some of the healthcare workers inside of the hospital are much more at risk, and to not assign them to care for COVID patients,
right,
and not assign them to go into any COVID contaminated areas or rooms in the hospital. Mm-hmm. And so we know that someone who is on, you know, radiation or chemo has their immune system depressed, right? Age is another factor. Respiratory illnesses. I mean, there's a list of factors, and we are also asking the hospital, all of the hospitals, not to put those employees at risk and keep them away.
Right.
Keep them away. We've also asked all of the hospitals to set up mobile units so that we are keeping, you know, possible COVID patients out of the general areas, like the emergency rooms. And so many of them have already done that or are working on it. We've also asked them to establish separate wings in the hospital where they would care for COVID patients, again, to reduce the risk. In a conversation with Alta Vista in Las Vegas, they are working on doing that.
Mm-hmm.
And I understand that also Taos, even though they're not talking to us right now, they are testing the patients in a separate area. But again, they still have to walk through the hospital.
But if they're not union members, I mean, they could reach out to you guys for that.
Oh, yes.
Or... Yeah, yeah. And they have been. I mean, everybody's calling us.
Everybody.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
I think I've gone through the list in terms of what we're asking the governor to do. Again, we're awaiting her response and hope that she will respond to us quickly so that we can also be a part of the planning that's going on in the state. I think because of the fact that we do represent healthcare workers, we have a unique opportunity to give them our recommendations. Some of these recommendations that we've been, you know, talking about with the hospitals, they hadn't even thought about them. And so I think that, you know, we're an essential element of that conversation. Anything else?
Can we just get you to say your names and spell them and also say your title?
Sure. My name is Eleanor Chavez, E-L-E-A-N-O-R, Chavez, C-H-A-V-E-Z. I'm the executive director for the National Union of Hospital and Healthcare Employees, District 1199, New Mexico.
And I'm Delma Delora, D-E-L-M-A, D-E, capital L-O-R-A, and I am the district president for District 1199, New Mexico.
And she's also an RN.
And I'm an RN. I've worked at the hospital for 56 years.
Think about that one. Any other questions?
Good.
Okay,
and
thank you all.
Ay, unta marisco.
No.
Yo,
go ahead.
Bueno, pues hablaré. Bueno.
Sure. I think he wants to do you.
We're not supposed to.